Amen. Those that can and will you stand with me?
Yes.
We're going to ask God's anointing. In spite of everything,
amen.
This is the day the Lord has made, and so we will rejoice. Do that with me right now, asking God's anointing and presence. Father, we are blessed, so thankful. God, so grateful for who you are this day. We know you are still in control. You are God. We rest in you right now. Depend on you right now. Magnify your great name as we enter into the worship and the word of God. Your blessing and favor and presence anointing through Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you.
I'm gonna
scheme of the enemy meant for evil. You turn it for good. Hallelujah. That's what Joseph said. That was meant to destroy me. It's actually there for my salvation. Hallelujah. Those things that come in your life, there's a reason for it. You may not understand it. I may not understand it. Your favorite counselor might not understand it. But God knows why it's coming into your life. And the devil would love nothing more than to destroy you. But you can't. He can't. He can't. No weapon has ever been formed that shall prosper. Hallelujah. Nothing can destroy us because we are a child of God. Hallelujah. I want to sing that one more time if we could. When we get to that part that says, you take what the enemy meant for evil, turn it for good. Make that your declaration this morning. Hallelujah.
There's power in the mighty name of Jesus. Every war he wages, he will win. Oh, I'm not backing down from any giant, 'cause I know how this story ends.
You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus.
sing once again.
The Proof of Your Love by Brooking Country.
All right.
Try your other mic. Try yours now.
Hello.
Whatever you want. Go ahead.
Thank you.
Bibles, turn with me to the book of Psalms, chapter 27. I'm going to read six verses there this morning that I think is going to be beneficial to us. Praise the Lord. Psalm 27 and 1. It's the Psalm of David. It says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is my strength and my life, of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, came upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. The host shall encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. The war shall rise against me, and this will I be confident. One thing. Have I desired of the Lord, and that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple.
Amen. Amen.
For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion.
Hallelujah.
In the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me.
Yes.
He shall set me upon a rock. Mm-hmm. And now shall my head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore will I offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing, yes, I will sing praises unto the Lord." Hallelujah. I want to preach on that fourth verse. One thing. One thing. Father, thank you for your word this morning. We ask God that you'd open our hearts and ears to receive, we pray, in Jesus' name. How often have you heard the instructions, "One at a time, please"? You ever heard anybody say that to you? I'm from a very large family, and there's a lot of us too. But when we gathered for dinner on Sunday, there was a lot of us in the room. And if we waited, sometimes we missed out. So we would just gather in, and sometimes you just have to jump right in there. You had to learn how to do that. Kind of like, I won't say it. Kind of like a bunch of pigs at a feeding trough. You know. Then you jump right in there and get on it. But, you know, doing one thing at a time is the opposite from juggling a lot of tasks. Some of you can do a lot of things at the same time. Some of you think you can do a lot of things at the same time, but you get distracted. Some of us and it's not a problem that you have a one-track mind. I mean, we understand that, you know. It does get to be a problem when you got too many things on your plate. You ever had that happen to you? You got too many things to do. And it's hard to get things right in your mind. It's hard to stay focused. One, he said, I'm going to do one thing. One is singular. One is specific. One is separate. One is on its own. It's the first primary number, and it signifies importance, prominence, independence. One stands on its own. There's an occasion to pause and ask ourselves about what's the most important thing, or what are you giving prominence in your life, especially in our busy world. You think, well, we're not so busy right now. I don't know who's not busy. But I gotta tell you, I'm probably busier now than we were. This sheltering at home or in place, you know, there's a lot of things at home that you can do that you no longer have an excuse not to do. And so, you know, you're busier sometimes than before the situation. Some of you are building a new house. You know, you didn't know you were, but you're taking one stick at a time. But you look up and say, wait a minute, you got a whole other room. But there's an occasion, I think, sometimes you sit back and say, what am I doing? What's going on in my life? What's number one in my life? What am I giving priority to? Now, there are 17 times that little phrase, one thing, appears in Scripture. And I'm not going to preach on all 17 of them this morning. There are appropriate places for amens, and there are inappropriate places for amens. That was one of those inappropriate places, Steve. But I'm just going to talk about three of them this morning, because I think these three kind of stuck out in my mind. They provided important questions to us, and actually they have provided an opportunity for us to evaluate our lives. Psalms 27 and then I read to you 1 through 6. David says one thing. He speaks about his one desire. If you could ask God for only one thing, what would you ask him for? If you had one request you could ask of God, you knew you would get it, what would you ask him for? What would be your desire? What would be your heart's thought? David's response was this. He's saying, I desire God above everything else. He said in Psalms 4, and I want to read this out of the message this morning. He said, I'm asking God for one thing and only one thing, to live with him in his house my whole life long. I'll contemplate his beauty. I'll study at his feet. He said, I'm going to ask God for this one thing, to live in his house with my whole life long. Is that your desire this morning? To be in his presence. That's what David was talking about. I want to be in his presence. Not only on Sunday mornings. Not only on worship day. But every day of my life. And then when this life is over, I want to extend it through eternity. He said, I want to be in your presence. Psalms 139 and verse 7 and 8 says, where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go to the heavens, you're there. If I make my bed in the depths, you're there. Everywhere David looked, he saw God. You see, you can be in God's presence no matter where you're at or what you're going through or what's happening in your life. You can still be in His presence. You may think, I can't be in God's presence because we can't be in church as often as we want. Yes, you can. You can still be in His presence. He writes, and as he's writing this, he feels overwhelmed. He's under attack. He realizes that his only safety is in the presence of God. Amen. That's where we're safe.
Hallelujah.
That you may not feel very safe at times, especially nowadays.
Amen. Mom.
Hello?
Yeah.
You may not feel safe. To be honest with you, we've gotten to where we very seldom answer the door. If I look out the peephole, we don't know you. Why would I answer the door?
Amen.
Hello?
Amen.
Now I'd say, Donna, who is it? What do they want? And she said, I'm not going to ask. We had somebody pounding on our door yesterday. Looked out the window, we don't know. You know, you read too many things. And I personally don't want to have to be in the news tomorrow. You can figure that one out. But David was going through a hard time. He said, I just want to be in God's presence. Psalms 27:5 says, for the day of trouble, He will keep me safe in His dwelling. He will hide me in the shelter of His tabernacle. He will set me upon a rock. His one request of God is that he might know Him and experience the awesomeness of His presence.
Yes. Amen.
And he seeks this with a singular determination. See, we wonder sometimes, I'm just gonna, since we're all family here, how many visitors are here? Well, that's because we can't have visitors right now. So we're all family. So I'm just gonna treat you like family this morning. We have to put God first.
Amen.
His one request is that he might experience God's presence. Is that your request this morning?
Amen.
Is that how you feel?
Amen.
Or you say, well, I'll experience God when I get time, when things aren't going on in my life. Let me tell you something. The enemy will always keep something going on in your life.
Amen.
And I think he is the master of busyness. And sometimes we're just too busy. If you're too busy for God, you're just too busy. Hello? If you're too busy for church, you're too busy.
Amen.
You need to make time.
Yes.
And that was his one request. Matthew 6:33 says, but seek ye first his kingdom, his righteousness, and all of these things shall be added unto you. We're seeking the things. We're chasing the rainbows, as it were, instead of seeking God. Instead of seeking his kingdom, he said, this one thing I do. Let me ask you, what is your one thing? What is your one thing? If it's not to be in God's presence, you need to reevaluate.
Amen.
You need to reevaluate where you are. Another word he gave us here was John 9 and 17. They say unto the blind man again, what sayest thou of him? And he hath opened thine eyes. He said, he's a prophet, but the Jews did not believe concerning him. They had been blind and received his sight until they called the parents of him that had received his sight. And they said to him, saying, is this your son? Who you say was born blind? Then how does he see? His parents answered, we know that this is our son, and that he was born blind, but by what means he now seeth, we don't know. Or who opened his eyes, we don't know. He is of age, ask him yourself. He can speak for himself. These words spake his parents because they feared the Jews. The Jews had agreed already that if any man did confess that he was Christ, he should be put out of the synagogue. Therefore said his parents of his age, ask him.
Then again called they the man that was blind, said to him, Give God the praise. We know that this man is a sinner. He answered and said to him, Whether he be a sinner or no, I know not. One thing I know is that where I was blind, I now see. Hallelujah. I don't know about everything else, but this one thing I do know. What do you know this morning? The man meets here. He can see things differently. He had one focus. He said, My life has changed. I can see now. I've got one thing I do know. I don't know a lot of things. You see, we don't have to know a lot of things. We just have to know one thing. We just have to know one person. We just have to know one solution. And that one solution is Jesus Christ. The man was born blind. Jesus healed him by putting mud on his eyes and telling him to go wash it off in the pool of Siloam. And God opened his eyes. God opened his blindness. The man hadn't seen Jesus at his healing. As his healing took place. After watching the mud off, he hadn't seen Jesus. He asked the Pharisees, Where is this man? And his answer was, I don't know. His parents were asked by the Pharisees how he was healed and who healed him. They said, We don't know. The people knew that they knew, and when they started to ask, Wasn't he blind yesterday? Isn't that the beggar who's been blind since birth? They called the man aside, asked him what happened. He said these words, A man called Jesus made some mud, put it on my eyes. He told me to go wash it, and now I see.
Amen.
The Pharisees hear about this incident. They decide to investigate. They question the man. They accuse Jesus of breaking the Sabbath. And thus being a sinner. They question his parents. They question the man again. We know Jesus is a sinner. Now catch what this man's response to the Pharisees were. Whether he's a sinner, I don't know. But one thing, it doesn't matter. See, that's your problem. You see, we want to look at society. Society wants to tell us this or that. We want to try to... Can I give you some advice? You don't have to convince society of anything.
Amen.
You know, I read with comedic interest at the blogs or arguments or whatever you want to call them. I read on Facebook, getting back and forth. This one argue with this one argue. I just laugh. You're not going to convince that person. They don't want to know. They're not concerned. They say, we don't know if he's a sinner or not. I don't know, but one thing I do know. I was blind, and now I see.
Amen.
You see, it's what he did for me. I know what he did for me. I was lost, but now I'm found. I know what he did for me. I was depressed, and now I've been lifted out of it. I know what he did for me. Hallelujah. Years ago, how many's ever heard of Herbalife? How many got suckered into it? I mean, got involved with it. You were going to make millions, weren't you? Almost as good as Amway. Well, Donna and I was privileged to be representatives of Herbalife. Isn't that wonderful? And we watched the video. And the gentleman who died at a very young age, he was an Herbalife, who was teaching the video, he said, people are going to come up to you and ask you, what's in this? What's this? What's this? You know, you just look at them and tell them, I don't know, but here's what it did for me. And I thought, you know, that's pretty good. Of course, it didn't ever do anything for me, but... You know, he said, I don't know all about that. I just know what it did for me. He said, that's your answer to any question they give you. I don't know about that, but I know what it did for me. Well, that's what Jesus, that's what this gentleman said. I don't know about that. I just know what he did for me. I don't know about all those ifs and ands and buts about all those questions. I just know what he did for me. He made me brand new. I don't know what he did for you, but I know what he did for me. He made me brand new this morning. Hallelujah. And I'm so glad to know that he can continue to do that. If he did it for me, guess what? He can do it for you this morning. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Jesus reached out to this man so that he could experience God in his life. See, when Jesus touched him, he experienced life. He changed. Can I say that again? He changed. How many have been changed in the room this morning? Hallelujah. Aren't you glad? See, he was no longer blind. He now could work. He no longer had to be a beggar all his life. He could rejoin society. He could worship God in the temple. His touch allowed him to experience God.
Thank you, Lord.
Perhaps you need a touch this morning from the Master. Maybe that's the one thing you need to experience the power of God in your life in a very practical way. One thing is for sure, when Jesus touched this man, he was never, ever the same again.
Amen.
His life was changed forevermore.
Hallelujah.
I think our life needs to reflect that same truth.
Yeah.
You see, when the man finally said, "One thing I do know, I was blind, but now I see." See, there's a lot in life and faith that we don't know. There's a lot in life we'll never know. But there's a truth that's so important that we do know. If I could truly understand one thing only, if you could truly understand one thing only, what would it be? Would you like to know how computers work? Would you like to know why they continue to sell Fords? Would you like to know how people can stand up and bald-faced lie to you and still get elected? I mean, there's a lot of things we may never know. He said, "I don't know anything about that. I just know that I was blind. And now I see. I just know that I was a drug addict and I'm free. I just know I was a drunk and now I'm not anymore. I just know that I was an abuser and I'm not anymore. I just know I was a hater and now I'm not anymore. I know what I was and now I know what God's done in my life. And I've been made a brand new creature. Old things have passed away and all things have become new." He had quite a different understanding about what happened to him. What he did know was that he was a changed man. John 9:25 said this in the message. I like the way the message reads. It says this. He says, "I know one thing for sure." Hallelujah. I know one thing for sure. And I do know one thing for sure this morning. If you allow Jesus to touch you, you'll never be the same.
Amen.
He can change you this morning. He can make you a new creature. He might not explain the theory of relativity. We got my tongue tied around my false teeth. He can't say a thing. It's one of the bad things about COVID. My two new teeth are still sitting in the shop. Probably shouldn't have shared that, should I? I don't know about a lot of things, but I know that. John 3 says, "Oh, what manner of love has the Father bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. Therefore, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. Beloved, now are we the sons of God. And it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him like he is." We know. So we can know that who we are and who we will be. And surely this has to be the one thing we know for certain. You don't have to know all this other stuff. But one thing you have to know for certain is the man that can change your life.
Amen.
the Savior that can change your life, and that's Jesus Christ. Our focus in life is ultimately determined by those things which we are certain of. Last thing I want to share with you, Philippians 3:12. Not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect, but I follow after, if that I may apprehend that for which I was also apprehended of Christ Jesus. Behold, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth unto the things which are before, pressing towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of Christ Jesus. This one thing I do. Hallelujah. There's one thing we can do. We can let go of those things that are in our past. The biggest destruction thing in our life many times is our past. We hang on to it. We nurse it. We say we'll never be different. We'll never be healed. You have to forget those things. Let those things go. And then press towards Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. You need to do that this morning more than anything else. Hallelujah.
Yes, Lord.
Now, there's a movie called City Slickers. Anybody ever see that? It's not a trick question. You think, well, tell him he's going to say it. He's going to preach at me about it. No. But it stars a man named Billy Crystal. It's a movie about three men who are searching for the meaning of life. Every year, these three friends would get together and go to a manly adventure. Aren't you glad you do that, Ben? Well, this particular year, they decided to take a trip to an actual working ranch and help move several hundred head of cattle in the cattle drive. That's a manly thing to do. I wouldn't mind doing it the way they do it nowadays. They all got ATVs. And they got motorhomes following them around. But while they're on this adventure, they meet their trail boss. His name is Curly. He's a very grim, gristle, rough, and tough cowboy who would lead them cross country. If you remember the story, he was played by
Jack Palance.
You had to take your mask off for me to hear you.
And how do I sound now?
Jack Palance, he was a man's man. And so as the story unfolds, the conversation between Billy Crystal and Curly takes place. Crystal asks Curly the meaning of life. Curly slowly raises his index finger and a gnarly old leather glove proceeds to expound on the meaning of life. The secret, he says, is one thing. But you have to find out that one thing for yourself. I thought he could be preaching that sermon this morning. He said, there's just one thing, but you got to find that one thing out for yourself. And there's a lot of truth in it. A lot of us is pursuing somebody else's one thing. Of course, Billy Crystal gets confused, but Curly just sits there silently, not even hinting what the one thing is. See, Paul was able to demonstrate that he had one purpose in life. If you could do one thing in your life, what would it be? Well, some of you say, I traveled around the world. What happens when you've done that? You're just giving me more evidence and more evidence. I'll sign the papers, Jerry. When you... John 4:34 said to my meat is to do the will of him that sent me. That's my purpose, Jesus said. That's my purpose in life. What's your purpose in life? Our problem is we're trying to find our purpose, or we're trying to do somebody else's purpose. Well, that sounds pretty good. Share your vision. That sounds good. I think I'm going to do that too. Man, I'm going to Romania. And that sounds exciting. Man, I don't know when I'll be back. Never mind, I saw some video. I've seen the landscape. I've seen the environment. No, I think I'll stay right here in Reno. Wendy's is just down the road. You're building a Cracker Barrel. There's none of those in Romania. You know. He said, my meat is to do the will of them that sent me. Jesus had one thing to do. That was to fulfill the will of God, the purpose of God that sent him into the world to complete it. That's my desire. That's what I got one thing to do, he says. Paul is clear about life's purpose. In 3 and 12, it tells us that there's more to do. He said, not that I've already attained. We're in Philippians. Not that I've already attained. I got more to do. I'm not done yet. How many ministers have sat around and say, well, I'm retired. How's it feel to be retired, Pastor Gladys? We won't let her retire. She's tried to retire several times. No, you can't retire. You got to preach. You got to give us a word. Brother Jerry, you're not ready to retire, are you? Yes. You see, one thing about pastors, they never retire. How's retirement feel, brother? He's not retired. Wait. Ray, how's retirement? It's not retired, is it? We don't retire. There's more to do. You don't retire in the Lord. You still have something to do. How many are breathing this morning?
Thank you, Lord.
You're not done yet then. If you're still here and you're still breathing, God still has something for you. I had a gentleman in our church one time that was on death's door. I mean, we had just taken the church, and just a couple of weeks later, he had an emergency and his medical condition put him in the hospital. He was on death's door, and he was in the hospital for several weeks. We were there actually every day, praying with him, being with the family, because they thought surely that was the day that he would be going home, and I'm as a pastor, I want to be with the family when something like that happens. We were in there every day for several weeks, praying with his brother. God pulled him through. And he looked at me one day and he said, Pastor, why did God allow me? Why did he keep me here? I looked at him and said, I don't know, but you need to find out. Because God's got something for you to do. I can't tell you what you need to do, but God's got something for you to do. He said, I haven't already attained. There's more to life. There's more that needs to be done. Verse 13 says, forgetting what's behind us, straining towards what's ahead. Don't get hung up. Forget those things that are behind you.
Amen.
Some of you say, well, I've lost millions of dollars. I sit back and I say to myself, if I had only not fallen off that roof that day, my, how things would be different. But I can't sit back and think about it. Would I have done a lot of things different? Yes. I would have called in sick that day.
Amen.
I'd have stayed on the roof. I wouldn't have come down. I'd have took a pillow with me. But you can't let the past keep you from pressing into what God has for you. I can't go back and change time. I often have said that. I wish I could just... If I could do one thing over, I'd do that over. But then I realized, no, God knows what he's doing. If he brings you to it, he will take you through it. He brought you to where you're at. He's not going to forget you. He's not going to abandon you. He's not going to leave you behind. He's going to take you forward. He said, I have not apprehended. I've not attained. But this one thing I do is I forget those things that are behind me. And I reach forward to what God has for you. That's what I do. I reach forward. Someone asked me the other day, who are you mentoring to take your place? I said, did you hear something I didn't hear? Maybe they know something. And I understand their philosophy, their teaching. You've always got to leave somebody behind. Because we're not going to be able to do this forever. But I have no plans of retiring.
Amen.
You know, I've changed physically. I'm not getting older. I'm getting more determined. Everything I do on purpose now. I plan my day. Usually it's 4 days ahead of me. But I'm not done yet.
Amen.
I'm not done yet. There's one purpose for the future. That is press toward the goal. That's what we do. We press towards the goal for the prize. What is the goal? A lot of people think heaven is the goal. No, heaven is not the goal. Heaven is the prize. He said, I press towards the goal for the prize. The goal is to be like Jesus. The goal is to do what Jesus wants you to do. And God has something for you to do today. God has something for you to do tomorrow. Don't think God doesn't have anything for you. Well, everybody's got it covered. Man, everybody's got it covered. We can't fit anymore and keep 6 feet on the stage. They got it covered. God has something for you to do.
Thank you.
I remember sitting around here one day, I was at my office at home, and I have an app on my phone that has our cameras. And I'm always checking our cameras because I keep an eye on Miss Donna. Not that I'm wondering what she's doing. I mean, I keep an eye on her so she doesn't get hurt. You know, see somebody messing around out around the building, I'll call and check on her. I'll run down here and check on her. And I was looking at the camera one day, and there's a little lady out there. Just giving Donna what for. Little white-headed lady. And she was just talking to Donna. And then on a Sunday morning, that little white-headed lady stepped into the building. And I realized immediately there's something different about that lady. She was not your run-of-the-mill average lady. And I, every now and then I'd see her, I said, that lady, don't you have a car? I asked her, you got a car? Because she walked everywhere. But she did that so she could talk to people. And I'm not going to tell you who it is, but she's married to Pastor Jerry now. But her purpose, every day, God led somebody into her life. I got to tell you something, and Pastor Jerry has told me this too. It seems like every day God will lead somebody into her life. And what does she? She takes advantage of that time. She preaches at them.
Praise God.
She tells them about Jesus.
Amen.
She'll walk up and give them a hug. Say, I love you. Here's some water. Here's this. You know, God's not through with her. She thought maybe, she didn't think she'd be married and be back in the ministry, but God's taking them places. Hallelujah. And you know what? God is not through with you. We have a purpose in the future. We've all said at one time or another, I have so much to do, and I know that. 21st century cliche is multitasking. When you can perform a lot of different operations at the same time. I can multitask. Donna will tell you this, that I used to drive a truck and I would be riding down the road doing 80 miles an hour, pulling 80,000 pounds, eating a sandwich in one hand, drinking coffee in the other, steering with my elbows, shifting with my knee. You know, that's every trucker. Don't worry, they're all that way. if you see a truck, you better move over. We say we have a lot of that. The problem is when you multitask. And I'm not giving you a bad time about it. But unfortunately, you're in the danger of never doing any one of them as well as you could have done. Multitasking leads to destruction. What's the one thing of all that's the purpose of your life? David said in 40:8, I desire to do your will, my God. The will of God is the one singular, specific, separate purpose he has for you. God's will for me is not God's will for you.
Amen.
Find out what God's will is for you and pursue it.
Amen.
I've been so blessed. We have one of the best, I'm just going to say it, one of the best artists I've seen in many years in our congregation. And every now and then, Brother Will, sitting there, will send me a picture that he's just drawn. A lot of times he's in service and he's drawn a picture. And you think he's scribbling. No, he's drawing a picture about what God is telling him about the service, about what God's doing, about the message. He'll send me a drawing. And beautiful. But that's his purpose in life. He knows what God's called him to do. Share the gospel. In drawing and in witnessing. He called me the other day. He said, I'm headed. He said, I want you to pray. We didn't have Sunday night service because they were having another protest, as it were. He said, pray for me. I'm headed downtown with my cross. You don't know this. He's got a 12-foot cross that he carries all over town. And he's headed downtown to carry his cross. He called me and I didn't say, I'm going with you. I said, I'll be praying with you. But God's called him to do things like that. But God didn't call you to do it. He didn't call me to do it. What God called me to do is different than what he called you to do. But you have to decide. David said, my desire is to do your will. See, the will of God is that one singular, specific, separate purpose that he has for you. Simply this, your life, by deciding what matters most, in your desires, focus, and purpose. You need to decide that. To be honest, it all reduces neatly down to one thing. Psalms 27:8. The message. When my heart whispered, seek God. My whole being replied, I'm seeking Him. Hallelujah. When my heart whispered, seek God, my whole being replied, I'm seeking Him. Is that what you're doing? When your heart says it's time to seek the Lord, is that what you do?
Amen.
So I want to say to you, Psalmist said, one thing I ask of the Lord. When he said that, he's putting God first. He said, one thing I know, that I've been changed. You say, one thing I do, Psalms 40:8, David said, I desire to do your will. What's your one thing? What's your purpose this morning? Let me challenge you this morning. If you don't know, you need to find out. I don't want to be the one to tell you this, but time is running out. You have very little time left to do that one thing that God's called you to do. Get specific with God and let Him show you what that one thing is. Sing the song with us.
Surrender.
just take a few moments and say, well, I don't know about that, Pastor. You're safe down here. You're safe. Will you take a few moments seeking Him? If there's not room down here, just kneel at your seat. Say, Lord, I surrender. I surrender this morning. How that happens. By surrendering.